imagine how the global economy could be headed for a recession when shoppers continue to go all out. For example, the 11/11 or Singles Day event, sales hit a record $38 billion for Alibaba alone, and American shoppers spending a whopping $69 billion over the Black Friday weekend. As we see, the last major sale event, 2019, happened today. That's 12/12 unfolding that shopping craze. We'll look at the e-commerce landscape in the Philippines and the evolving psyche of shoppers. This morning, we talked to a startup that believes online shopping is more than just the usual suspects, Lazada, Zalora, or Shopee. Josh Supan, CEO of X-panse Technologies. Great to have you on the show, Josh.
Good morning. Thank you for
having me. Okay, so let's start with, how are you different from the other online marketplaces like Lazada and Zalora?
All right, so for X-panse, we're more of an e-commerce enabler. Mm-hmm. When you say e-commerce enabler, you don't bring them to one site. You build multiple sites for different brands. So what we do in X-panse is we help them in terms of web development and fulfillment. So we empower brand.coms as opposed to being in a marketplace. X-panse is not a marketplace. We're more enabling other brands to have their own brand and then wear SKU on their socials and everything. So we're more in that field.
So that's like, you've got other web developers like Shopee, but what makes you different is you handle the logistics. It's an automated logistics platform called Noah,
yes.
And you are able, with all your clients, your whole network, to aggregate these delivery or shipment orders.
Yeah, that's the perfect word for it, actually, is aggregation. So Noah is built to collect data from multiple websites, and once they collect a certain order, the experience is, once we get the order, a courier goes to whoever my vendor is automatically the next day for pickup and delivery. So there's no need for a vendor to call a courier by themselves or go to like a courier dashboard and upload the data. The data seamlessly passes through from the website to the courier systems automatically. So that's what we do, connecting multiple websites to multiple couriers. And Noah has a smart algorithm where we choose the best courier for certain locations for certain vendors.
Mm-hmm. And is it where you also make money, the logistics?
Yes.
Because for Lazada, that's how they make money. They don't charge any more commissioners fee.
Yeah.
They just make money from the couriers.
On our end, we don't really make money on the logistics shipping cost. Mm-hmm. We charge a 2% or 20 pesos for every order that passes through. That's more of our commission
That's a clean 2%.
Yes. Yeah, it is.
That is profit. Already.
Yes, I would like to say.
When you develop these websites, who makes money from the ads on those websites? Would it be you or the brand?
The brand, definitely.
The brand makes
money. So it's more on. So, for example, I'll give one of our website packages would be around 25,000. Mm-hmm. But once you pay that monthly subscription, that's your site.
That's a monthly subscription.
Yeah, okay. Yeah. So you can do whatever you want with it. If you want to want people to.
But
make
you guys
ads
design
there,
it.
Yeah. Yes, we can also design, but a lot of our partners right now, a lot of our vendors prefer to have their own design because they have their own identity.
Do you find that a lot of our traditional retail giants are getting into the digital space?
Oh, yes, definitely.
I know that one of your clients would be SSI Group, big brand.
Yeah. Sorry, can you repeat your question?
The SSI Group. Do you think that more of the traditional retailers are getting into this digital bandwagon?
Especially here. I would say, like, when we started the company in 2017, we noticed that even big brands here in the Philippines don't have websites yet or are not really delving into the e-commerce game yet. When we started and we started offering our services, since we're cheaper and we're faster, people started really becoming more aggressive when it comes to launching their e-commerce programs, and retailers are now making it a point to have that option.
And what has been the impact on their top line or bottom line?
So you call it the contribution of e-commerce. Mm-hmm. So before, you would say that the contribution would be around 1% to 2%. So it is the entire sales of a certain retailer, and then let's say 1% is made up of e-commerce. But now it's growing to around 8% to 12%. So you're seeing that e-commerce now is being, if you have, let's say, 20 brick-and-mortar stores and one e-commerce site, and that e-commerce site is making 12% of your revenue, then that's really significant. Mm-hmm. And that jump from 1% to 12% is
really
massive.
How big is your network of clients? How many clients do you have right now?
Right now, we're contracted to like launch our around 200 macro brands right now. Mm-hmm. Right now, we have around, let's say we've built around 40 to 50 brand.coms here in the Philippines.
Mm-hmm. And how many transactions per day do you see? Do your per website day. See?
We Over. Have around, we're already well beyond the 1,000 mark per day. Uh-huh. So in a month, we get like close to 30,000 in a month's time. Mm-hmm. Yeah, so that's also a lot if you really see through it.
And I imagine that's a lot of data that you're able to crunch.
Yes.
So what sort of insights or trends can you share with us when it comes to Filipino consumers online?
Oh, well, okay. So there's really an uptick when it comes to transactions, when it comes to, you know, Filipino shopping online. And that's the thing. Brand.coms is not like a market. The main difference between a brand.com and a marketplace is usually when you go to a marketplace, it's something you need. It's like, I don't know, like toilet paper or, I don't know, a power bank and all those things. So they're top of mind when it comes to that. Brand.coms and brand.coms, they focus on more on the wants of customers. Because let's say I want that Zara shirt, I want that Gap shirt. Those are stuff that they aspire for. So you can see now that their mindset now is, okay, at least I'm not just using e-commerce for stuff I need, I'm also using it for stuff I want. You can see now that we're really targeting a lot of female customers, especially in the skew of, let's say, 25 and above, because they're really our shopping market. But yeah, my generation, I'm 27 years old, we can see that majority of us really, like, it's ingrained in our system that it's okay for us to shop online, and we're more comfortable with it.
So who would you say, which demographic is the
largest contributor?
The largest buyer?
I would say,
and what time do they usually do the shopping?
Yeah.
Do you have like data that shows, okay, this group of people, they usually scan, but they never click the add to cart. These group of people, when they scan, they usually buy.
Yeah. If you're within the range of 24 to 35, that's the range that you usually will buy. Mm-hmm. When teenagers buy, we get a lot of complaints that teenagers, like from, let's say, 12 to 18, yes, they do add to cart, but they use their mom's credit card and they wait for their mom's credit card. So definitely, it for the individual, it's like around 24 to 35. Those are our main demographics, mm-hmm. for who buys from our websites. It can go boys or girls, but really majority women here. And funny, the times that are really hitting the e-commerce targets are around 12 noon and 12 midnight. So during lunchtime or before they sleep. So mm-hmm. it's really skewing both ways.
And what are the online bestsellers that we have now?
Our online bestsellers. Mm-hmm. Well, really,
I imagine fashion. It's fashion, yes. More luxury fashion.
Yes, luxury fashion.
Not the commodities. Not commodity style.
Not really. Not
and would these brands also, since you're not part of the marketplace where you've got 12-12, 11-11, do these sites also see a big jump or spike during these
It spills over, definitely.
Brand.
Yeah, because people now are aware. Let's say if 12-12 hits and stuff like that, brands now are more conscious where, okay, these people are... it's like an e-commerce day, basically. So we really thank the marketplaces for really making this a thing, 11-11, 12-12. So it spills over to the brand.coms. But I'd like to say that it's not really their peak for brand.coms. It's not really their peak time. It's more of the marketplace peak time. Brand.coms is more of a sustainability model. So it's like sustainable orders, whether it's not a sale or not.
I'm very curious, Josh, because you launched this in 2017.
Yeah.
Or 2018.
2017.
2017, yeah. The company went broke twice, even before launching.
Yeah, unfortunately.
You have the story of being a pastor's son.
Yeah, yeah.
You've grown it. And 2 years in, mm-mm. you're actually confident that you can be the second. You're breeding the country's second unicorn star.
Yeah, we're very confident because... we're two things. It's really crucial when you're a tech startup, you're two things. Number one, it's you're smart, so you know what you're doing. So we'd like to think that we're really smart and we know what we're doing.
The Filipino has the brain power, okay.
Yeah, and number two, you're lucky. There's really an element of luck into it and stuff. So we were lucky with our first few clients and they turned out to be big clients.
I'd imagine. They are very big clients,
yeah,
big brands.
Yeah, so we have to be respectful of them and stuff. Mm-hmm. So,
So when are you going to make that $1 billion mark valuation?
Well, the valuation, well, hopefully next year. Uh-huh. We're really looking to close our seed round early next year, around hopefully first quarter, we finalize it already. It's really difficult for us since when we started X-panse, we just wanted to make a good product. We just wanted to have a business. Me and my founders were not really rich kids or whatever. We started it as, you know, okay, let's start something on our own. Let's see if we can do something. And in terms of like raising money and stuff like that, those were new concepts to us. How are we gonna do this? How do we want this? But when we started, you know, having traction and our client base and stuff like that, people started taking notice of.
So you're gonna be the second unicorn in the Philippines after Robbie Antonio's revolution.
Yeah.
Prefabricated.
Yeah.
$1 billion mark
valuation.
Yes. Valuation next year, and the goal is to make 35 million pesos monthly revenues.
Yes.
And you're more than halfway.
We're more than halfway. Yeah.
Amazing. And in one interview, you said your company thinks like a Western company but acts like a Chinese company.
Oh, okay. I remember saying that. So, in terms of thinking like a Western company, I always hear from people that living in the Philippines is really unique because whatever's working in the States will work here eventually in, let's say, 4 to 5 years' time. So you have to have a close ear to the ground when it comes to what they're doing in the States. So when you're thinking like a Western company, you understand that. But when you're acting like a Chinese company, that means you are hand in pocket. So a typical thing that startups do is when they get money, they spend it, and then they overspend and they don't budget and all those things. But we're very frugal.
So you're a conservative.
Yeah.
This is final question. After the Philippines, where to?
We're really looking into Thailand, Vietnam, and Indonesia for our expansions because we have partners already there willing to help us there. So we're really, we're really adamant that we want to have a Filipino team doing these things for us.
And do you think we have Filipino talent?
Of course,
to fill
yes.
your posts?
Yeah, no question.
No problem hiring?
No problem.
Okay, on that note, thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
We're excited to hear the news that you're actually the second already.
Hopefully. Thank you. Nice to meet you.
To watch more ANC videos, subscribe to the official ANC YouTube channel and click the bell button for more updates.